hi everybody. I'm Mahmoud Zedan. I'll introduce myself later on, but I would like to tell you that this panel may be a small panel, but they have a big idea that will change basically your lives. So you guys need to pay attention, and I'll come back to you later. Please go ahead, introduce yourself.
Hello everyone. I'm Barista Mani Becky Orock, IP attorney, a graduate from Abuja Law School, Nigeria. Thank you. It's a great privilege to be before you this evening. You're welcome.
Hi, I'm Persis. I work for Reliance Big Entertainment. I'm the legal attorney out there, and I've always been into films and content producing and protecting the IP in there. So it's a great privilege to be here.
Hi, my name is Mohammed Farrukh Irfan Khan. I've practiced for 30 years in intellectual property law. Then in 2010, I accepted an offer to become a judge of the High Court in Pakistan, went back to my home country and served for 10 years. I retired earlier this year, and I'm really lucky that my firm has asked me to come back as an off counsel to the firm to look after its practice in the Middle East. So I'm back with my IP community and the legal community.
Great, thank you very much. So guys, as I said, I'm Mahmoud Zedan. I'm the head of legal for Yokogawa Middle East and Africa, and I have also an international role in Yokogawa Global. And for those of you who doesn't know, I'm an introvert, right? So I devised this method to help me with the stage fright, right? So if I do like this, you guys need to give me one clap, okay? Yalla? No, just one. If you give two, you pay the price. Okay, yalla. Great, okay. So you need to pay attention, guys, because there is consequences for not doing this. Okay. So yeah, carrying forward this session, now we have, in the Middle East and Africa, of course, we have some challenging jurisdictions, right? So how do you actually protect your intellectual property in these jurisdictions? And I will ask maybe Mr. Mohammed to just give a brief about what jurisdictions do we have here that are challenging. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. You see, we are Middle East and Africa is termed as jurisdictions which are emerging. But I must say, and I must confess, that we are sitting in a jurisdiction in United Arab Emirates, which is far ahead of many developed countries also. So it depends on the thinking and the policy of the government. When I started practicing over here in 1985, nobody had even known what the law intellectual property was. The law came in 1991, and it took many years to understand what intellectual property and how it has to be executed. Matters went to the normal courts, and it took years and years, and of course the judges were not trained, they did not have any experience. But now, for the last 10 years, under the provisions and the guidance of the ruling, the rulers, the specialized framework has been provided in United Arab Emirates, which provides for speedy dealing with infringement matters, more so in trademark matters, where you could register your trademarks with the customs authorities, then the customs authority look at the infringing goods which are coming into United Arab Emirates. If there are infringers on the street, you can give a complaint to the DED, which is the economic department, and they would conduct a raid on behalf of the potential trademark owner. So this has improved the enforcement regime tremendously. Of course, going to the court is still very expensive, in not only in United Arab Emirates, but in Saudi Arabia, in other Gulf countries. In Africa, there is also difficulty because I have been a judge in also one of the developing countries. The court system is clogged up with general litigation matters. And judges do not have the background in intellectual property law, so they shy away from what intellectual property causes come before them. And they do not have the time. They are dealing with criminal matters, they are dealing with property matters, they are meeting with family matters, and each court, especially in the Indian subcontinent, even the courts of ordinary jurisdiction are clogged up with work. So intellectual property cases gets adjourned by most of the time. And our clients, when I was a lawyer, would not understand why a case is fixed for a particular date of hearing and is never taken up, because it was number 70th on the list of cause list and it never came in the 8 hours that the poor judge was working on that matters. So in Egypt, there are some reforms which are taking place for intellectual property. Sudan has put up a Khartoum intellectual property tribunal. So in this manner, the governments are coming alive to it. So
thank
I think there is improvement, but still a lot needs to be done in the area.
Yes, thank you very much. So, Persis, I understand you're in content creation, right?
Yes.
So, okay, content creation. How do you actually license this in a challenging jurisdiction? Because you give the license today, and tomorrow we are out in the open. So, how would you do this?
I'm sure everybody out here watches movies content either in the theater or on our OTT platform. So I work both the ways. So I'll just dissect that into two parts. Mm-hmm. First of all, as a content creator, as a generator, intellectual property begins right at the writing stage. So for me, a writer is very important because it creates the literary portion of the work. And after 1.5 years, when that gets converted to an audiovisual content, and after 250 people work on a project, and it gets showcase in the market in terms of theatrical exploitation. So we send our movies approx into 70 countries. That's how everybody gets the chance to view the Hindi content as well as English. But when I do my licensing, so I enter into overseas theatrical distribution agreement with the theater owners and make sure that my file doesn't get leaked out or gets pirated in any form or manner. That is another technical discussion which I don't want to bring up here, but I am very equipped with that sort of thing. So that is for my film creation. Now when we do work with the OTT platform owners, when I create content for them, my job is only to ensure that whatever I'm creating from the actors, directors, writers, I get that assigned to us as a production house and then further license it to the OTT platforms. Nowadays, the OTT platforms have become very smart. They want a back-to-back indemnity, saying that if the leakage is at your end, then you will be held responsible and not us. But then there is a lot of piracy going on in the world. So also I ensure that when I send my content to the OTT platforms, it's locked in a certain manner. And then that content again gets exploited worldwide. But then that responsibility falls on the OTT platform and not us. So when I work as a studio, my laws are different. When I work as a production house for a platform, the rules are different. Yeah.
Okay. So Becky, now you're working in which jurisdiction?
I'm working in Cameroon, Africa. We cover a lot of that, and we do more on litigation and counterfeiting. And what we should know this evening is that IP rights in challenging jurisdiction is because a lot of people in Africa don't know anything about IP. IP is just being introduced now in Africa. The courts are so ignorant about it. The judges are not trained towards handling IP matters. So that creates a lot of confusion because you as an IP attorney, most times you are frustrated because you see what is right, but the judge doesn't know how to apply it. He doesn't have any books on IP, he doesn't know anything on IP, but because he is the court and the Bangui agreement has specified that matters relating to IP should be tried before their courts. So when we get there, we are frustrated. But as time goes on, they are beginning to try, make an effort to know methods to apply when IP matters come before them. It's a very challenging thing to us as IP attorneys. At times, we need to go and try to give them books to read on that and all that. But what is now being done is, as an IP attorney that I'm versed with IP and also doing a lot of litigation in the ordinary, like what am I trying to say? I am a barrister at law, so I handle issues, criminal and both the IP. So when I face such situations, what I do if the matter is not very critical, we go to alternative dispute resolutions. We look at other methods on how to handle such issues. It can be through mediation, conciliation, arbitration. And once that is done, if the parties agree on the decision that is being taken, we just forward it for court for it to be enforced.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Guys, you need to pay attention now. Yalla? You guys are sleeping. Somebody has to tell me a joke, so I'm going to choose now. You have to tell a joke. Okay. That's a joke in itself.
Check.
Okay. So, guys, like, jurisdictions such as UAE and, I don't know, Egypt and so on, and these are not challenging jurisdictions. How would you protect your intellectual property rights in Iran, let's say? Now, Iran is under sanctions.
Yeah, but the exception is actually intellectual property law. There's no sanction on protecting intellectual property law. But still, life is very difficult.
Exactly. How would you hire an attorney that's not affiliated to, like,
it's very difficult to send money in Iran. It is very difficult to communicate with Iran. But all the major companies are doing business, you know, who are doing business or who have intellectual property rights of any sizable or any valuable nature. They do want to protect in Iran. It is one of the major countries. So this is the difficulty. Another difficulty has come up recently with the strained relation between Qatar and the rest of the GCC countries, you see. So there was a seamless operation in the Gulf. It has been disrupted for a while, you see. So these challenges are always there, will be there. It is for your attorney, for your lawyer, you know, for you to know how to navigate these problems, you see. And the good thing is that at least in the Gulf, the tendency and there is an appreciation of the value of intellectual property. I, as a counsel, would not advise clients to go for litigation because it can be very expensive. There are alternate means of enforcing your intellectual property right. We have had experts like Abir, you know, who have combed the market for their products like Adidas. You see, they have taken actions on a specialized product like Danfoss. So the administration, the administrative authority is the best in the world, I would say, over here, in terms of cooperation, you see, in terms of understanding. There is a general sense and general air for understanding intellectual property because this region has understood that its success is with intellectual property. So this is a very positive notion. In many countries, the governments do not understand what intellectual property rights is. And although, you know, that is very important for any company to look at the investment portfolio that they want to bring to that country.
Okay, and Persis?
Add up to that. So even when it comes to piracy, so what we have started doing as a studio now is that if we have a huge budget movie, which is going to be released in the market, and we have this threat of piracy, we hire an agency in India. And they have now tied up with all the lawyers and the police force in the foreign countries, and they generate a report on a daily basis that how many times the movie has been downloaded through the torrent, and they send us a report, and then they ask us that in case if you want to, you know, file a litigation or, you know, seize the laptop or if we want to have a way forward on the infringement, so they call us and keep checking with us. So that has come up very well in India. And adding to Sir's point, I really understand when we had started this IP thing in India 10, 15 years before, no lawyer was equipped to handle cases. And over a period of time, what the industry has started doing is that they engage the people from the industry, maybe sometimes as arbitrators, or we conduct workshops wherein we educate students or the lawyers or the business teams then how to protect your intellectual property. Basically, intellectual property is nothing but a property which is created through an intellect. It's not like a house or a car which we own. When we can protect that, we can always protect the IP which we create. So, and then you have to monetize it. But the minute it is infringed, nobody will want to take it forward.
So before the sanctions, did you guys sell anything into Iran or?
No. Okay. I don't have to get into those things as of now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. So now, Becky, did you guys do business with like sanctioned country before? Any sanctioned country?
Yeah, there are sanctions. Usually, there are sanctions for that. Like, when we discover that such situations are being taken into place, sometimes people rush to the police to get them, to get their rights being protected. For example, like in cases of counterfeiting, once it is discovered that your good has been counterfeited, instead of going through the court process of litigation, which is very slow and sometimes takes a lot of time, and before you want to realize it, the material, the evidence is being destroyed. So what people do most of the time is that when they discover that their good has been counterfeited and is being kept in a warehouse, they rush to the police and say, come and see. And the police rush there and grabs the goods and that they can get a solution to it. But if they want to follow legal proceedings by filing, writing motions and all that, before you know it, the goods are disappeared. So what we advise, as an IP attorney, what I advise is, in cases of counterfeiting, like a good has been counterfeited, what I advise is we do an ex parte motion. What is an ex parte motion? An ex parte motion is being filed in court. It's a motion being filed without notice. You don't put the other party on notice. You file it and take the other party by ambush.
Okay. So let me take this to you guys now. Did any of you like prosecute or like litigate in a sanctioned jurisdiction before? And you have to understand that I have so much light in my face I cannot see you if you're raising your hand. So, okay. So let me ask you another question. Do you talk to people to protect your intellectual property in sanctioned jurisdictions? Like Iran is under sanctions, right? Yokogawa itself was the company I'm the head of legal for. We had this guy who was claiming that he is Yokogawa. He's using our trade name, he's using our trademark, he's saying that he's selling our product. How would you go about this? Like, I'm trying to take legal advice here. Go on, help me, guys. Okay, so somebody has to come.
I can give you an answer.
Yeah, sure.
You see, intellectual property right transcends borders, you see. So if you take famous trademarks, they would go to sanctioned, or they don't understand the sanctioned or non-sanctioned countries. There would be a reputation. Today, the world is much smaller, much closer with the internet, where sanctioned countries are using internet also, you see. By the way, Iran closed down its internet for the last few days because of the rioting over there. So there is no internet connection at the moment. But when a right holder, a trademark owner or a patent owner sees that its rights are being infringed in a sanctioned country, they are perturbed, they are disturbed, because one thing is doing business locally, the other thing is that product can be exported from that country to
exactly,
a market.
Yes.
So there are ways and means to deal with those. Very good law firms are functioning in Iran. They are excellent lawyers, they are excellent people, they are highly educated, you know, they have studied from all over the world, they understand the notions. It's just a matter of knowing the right person, and the courts are functioning. You could do that. I have dealt with intellectual property rights of my international clients in countries like Cuba, in countries like North Korea, you see, which are on far more stronger, but the US sanction gives an exemption to intellectual property rights. Even US companies go and protect themselves in those countries.
But working for a Japanese company, we're always scared to go into this kind of...
No, you see, there is a level. If you're doing a business transaction, then maybe you are... although I'm not an expert on these sanctions, but the general law which I have looked up and I have dealt with for my clients is that intellectual property is exempt. You can own and obtain intellectual property rights. You can send money for that particular purpose. It does not come under the sanctions.
Okay, so we actually found a solution for that, a solution I devised somehow. I bullied the internet service provider. So I sent him like emails all over again, like I sent him dozens of emails saying that we will sue.
But
the internet service provider. Yeah.
I would just like to add is that actually with our topic is that the art of no litigation.
Yes.
See, as an in-house counsel, when I draft my contracts, my first motive, I don't rush to draft anything. When I get my download from my business teams, I actually sit down with them, I draw a diagram. There's a lot of homework which happens. I just don't start, churning out my documents like that. First of all, because my back end, my thought process is that this document should never ever reach to a court of law. At least in our Bollywood industry, nothing should go to the court. Nowadays, it is a fast process. We have injunctions and we have John Doe orders. But when you start drafting, the first thing is that who is your target audience? I have also come across place at times in my career when people cannot even pick up a pen to sign the contract. Now, I have to explain them what are they signing. And it can be in any language in India. But it should never go to the court of law. Now, how do I protect that? If I'm acquiring a concept, if I'm acquiring a story from somebody, my first homework towards that is chain of title. It has to be clear. If there is any leakage or a broken chain of title from one person to the 10th person, because if I am the third person in the line and from me it has to go to the 10th person, the hand should not break. The minute that hand is broken, it will lead to litigation. Because there are 10 people who wants to claim the story, there are 100 people who will come and say that this movie was based on my real life story. So we do a lot of background check. Because that person has an access to the court of law, and once if it is filed in the court, it will again affect your revenues which you will earn from the exploitation of the IP. So as a studio, as a production house, as a service provider, for me as an in-house counsel, there are many parameters which I keep a check on. And it should never go to the court. This is the art that first, I mean, we need to see, even when we do cross-border transactions, when I deal with my US companies, and when we acquire stories and concepts from them, I make sure that if they have registered with any, is it registered with SAG, is it registered with our Indian Writers Association, or it is registered with the Copyright Society of US or India, Trademark Registry, everything, even the character what we build up, say Spider-Man or there are so many characters in Avengers, Iron Man. Yes. Tomorrow, if I have to make a movie on that, there will be so much of paperwork to actually license that character and bring it into my story. But to make sure that the studio doesn't file a case on me.
What's your favorite like character?
My favorite? I have many in the Indian, in the Bollywood industry.
And I think Becky here is not happy because we are talking about no litigation. You need to make money, right? So.
Yeah. Seriously, each time we hear about non-litigation as a lawyer, as a barrister, which is our field, you know, if someone is selling coffin, what his prayer is people should die. He will not blame him, that's his business. So if they say pray for your business, you'll be praying that people should die so that they should buy coffin. Equally, it's the same thing in the legal field. If there is no litigation, how would the lawyers survive? But as the years goes by in practice, what I have discovered as a young counsel is that more often it is successful to get a bad judgment than to go through litigation. What am I trying to say? In cases of infringement of whatever intellectual property right it may be it patent or trademarks, you have to struggle to talk to the both parties, because most of the times if we don't give them proper advice on the disadvantages of going through litigation, your client has so much confidence in you knowing that as an IP counsel, you're going to win the case. And he waits and waits and waits and doesn't get any solution and he becomes frustrated. So what we do normally is, before we handle any case on infringement, we talk to the party that has brought the case, that if the other party can comply through negotiation, mediation, or conciliation, just accept and let it be. Sometimes, what are the solutions? When you talk to the parties, the other party may decide to withdraw all the goods in case of counterfeiting, may withdraw all the goods that he has produced or set them on fire, disappear the evidence so that it doesn't exist any longer. But seriously, we encourage litigation, because with litigation, the public is aware of IP. It's a kind of way of educating, sensitizing the public about IP rights. because many don't know about their rights. And many equally are ignorant that there are some gifts that they have that can be registered under IP rights. So during litigation, they know one or two things about it, but honestly, as a counsel, as a lawyer, being honest, litigation is not the best. Okay, so other methods are the best.
You're saying litigation is not the solution?
Litigation is not the solution.
Okay, great.
It's not. Advising and drafting is the solution, I guess.
Yes, you have to start somewhere. You have to start in the license.
You see, successful lawyers and successful law firms don't lead their clients to litigation.
Yeah.
I would second this notion which has been put forward by Becky. And because, you know, if it is inevitable, you go for litigation. But as a lawyer, you must find an alternate solution. You know, you should know who the opponent of your client is. So it depends if it is a multinational corporation, you know, and the opponent is also a multinational corporation. Somewhere there is an association where they can sit down and settle their issues, you see. So you must take that issue. For example, pharma industry does meet regularly. Their general counsels meet the general counsels of other, and they decide. And so secondly, you must draw a set of your claims and send it to the counsel or the solicitor of the other side. It is 90% in my experience that the other side solicitor is also, you know, from a good firm. They understand what you're talking about. So if you're 100, you've sent 10 claims, you would come to a solution where 8 claims will be, you know, marked out. So you will be left with 2 claims. Those can be discussed over with, or, you know, if finally you have to go to the court, you're going for 1 or 2 particular claims, so you don't have to spend that extra money in discovery process, in filing evidence, in getting a witnesses, examined. So, and this reduces the cost for the client, and clients like that, you see. So there are solutions. Lawyers don't go, without money. You know, they work, but they get the client's confidence, and this is what we are supposed to do as lawyers. Alternate dispute resolution is coming up very fast. In UK, they have now established what they call enterprise court. So these enterprise courts are now for small claims, you see. So small and medium-sized industry or inventors, they can take their claim. In some countries, they are called small causes claims. So this is also being taken up in India, probably,
in
Pakistan.
India.
You know, this is from the common law jurisdiction. Yes. Another aspect is what is the jurisdiction, you see, where you're working. If it is a civil law jurisdiction, matter can be straightforward because the courts apply the law, you know, as it is written in the books. Yes. But if it is a common law jurisdiction, there could always be an interpretation which is dependent on the judge's ability to understand, or your lawyer's ability to make the judge understand.
Yes.
So these are the issues which you should consider.
How many of you guys actually finished IP litigation within a 1 year time frame?
Finished?
You did? You finished it? Can I get your card?
We have finished. I mean, I can't disclose the names and all of that, but I think for us, in day in, day out, when I receive legal notices from the lawyers, I don't rush to the court to file a case against that person.
Okay.
It's always better to send out send out a reply to that, and then maybe open a discussion or a conversation saying that this is what has come across from your lawyers and this is where we stand, and let's come across and sit on the table and settle it out. See, eventually I've realized that even if it goes to the court, settlement, as Becky said, is the final solution. So might as well first settle it out.
Are we opening for questions?
Yes.
Guys, are we opening for questions? I cannot hear you. Are we? Okay. So I cannot see you guys, so the organizers has to, yeah, please, go ahead.
Yeah.
Normal procedure for the enforcement, no company wants to go to court. and we were obliged to go to court. So what we did, I just lobbied with the government that they changed the procedure and worked on finding solutions, storage, where the police or the government has their
the material.
Under the government control. So I think it's not, we cannot say, in my opinion, we cannot say this jurisdiction is very challenging and we have this problem and this problem. In my opinion, lobbying can help in solving this problem. So I want to know your view.
Equally, that is what I said, that most of the times if you discover that there is a good somewhere that belongs to you, that has been infringed, you rush to the authorities. That's what I mentioned, that you rush to the authorities and they will come and seize the goods so that the evidence does not remain with the infringer.
Yes, but you said that it would be leaked again to the market.
No, leaked in the market in the sense that what if the goods has already gone into the market? No, I didn't. Sorry, you didn't get me very well. I said once there is you discover that your goods somewhere, you rush to the police to lobby, and the police rushes and seize the goods. Reasons being that if the goods are not seized and are being left to the infringer, he might disappear the evidence. If you want to just go straight for litigation, and that's why I said litigation is not always the first step to take. You lobby first. Yeah. Because if you want to rush to litigation before you come back, the evidence might not be there. So what you do is you rush to the authorities, those that are in place to assist you. The police can rush in there and seize the goods. But if you say, no, let me follow legal procedure, let me rush first and go and see my lawyer, and your lawyer does not give you a proper advice, yes, the lawyer start writing petitions and motions to file before the court, and before you know it, those petitions are filed before the court, but where is the evidence? And once there is no evidence, the case will be thrown out.
Usually, companies with economical power can do this lobbying. We have done this before, not Yokogawa, my previous company.
But there's also one challenging aspect with the lobbying is that you might be lobbying and the person is lobbying to a higher authority. That's what we face.
Exactly, so you have to have the economic
that's
power
what we face
to actually
most times.
Move their authorities, like in this kind of jurisdictions in Africa.
That happens in most of the countries.
You rush to lobby, you rush to a police station, the police goes there and sees the goods, and now the infringer calls the commissioner.
Exactly.
And he says, bring all those goods, and he dispatches them. What do you do? No, I'm saying lobbying, authorities. Yes. It can be
authorities, what I mean, authority is the decision maker.
Like the government.
That they call
the government, basically.
I'm very sorry to say that in as much as we don't want to blackmail our government, you can as well go and lobby with the government and the person calls another government that is greater than that government.
Yes, there is a
and
question.
And they call you and
lobby.
They say, please dispatch those goods. So those are the things
there's
we face.
A notion
every
of caution in lobby. Because it's not like in the U.S., it's an industry, you see, or in some countries, or it could be against the law of the country to lobby, you see. So you have to first see whether you are not again going against the law, especially in some of the African countries.
This is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's against the law, but the procedure, the process is wrong.
Yeah, it is, but then you have to look at illegal practices of your parent corporation, you know. If you lobby, I understand. But, you know, there is a presumption which is attached to it that it could be. You see, it could interaction with government authorities. You have to look at the local law. You have to look at what are the policies of the parent company. Some companies do not allow their counsels to go and approach some government officials for a particular matter, you see. So, and be sure. Also, you have to talk to your counsels that they do not go with any presence when they are, you know, doing the lobbying. So that will be illegal altogether.
Internal policies, internal ethics, we all follow.
Yes, I understand.
And you know, but we are trying to enhance the procedure. And sometimes we are invited to a conference in Baku. They wanted to develop their procedure and share experience. And after this conference, they changed the part of their procedure.
Yeah.
But I think you know this that comes yeah. up
that's,
comes
that's
up
the invitation
as
has
occurs.
Come from the government, yeah. so it's they want to enhance.
Okay. Can I ask what?
Yes, yes.
The lobbying in that sense is not lobbying, is actually enhancing and
correct.
Putting your hands with the government. For example, I am in a pharmaceutical company. We work a lot with the Ministry of Health in order to enforce and to, you know, we find ways to enforce our, because we have patents, we have products, we have brands, logos, trademarks, a lot of things. And this kind of lobbying, and actually the UAE government, by the way, is very much putting a lot of attention on IP protection.
Yes.
And on the at the same time, they also want a fair market and fair competition. So they will allow after patency, for example, the generics to come into the market. So, but there is an understanding between the pharmaceutical companies and a communication with the Ministry of Health to implement that government strategy, which is protecting IP rights and following, you know, the global.
Exactly. Lobbying in this sense yeah. doesn't. Yeah. Hurt anybody,
they will do,
yeah.
by the way, and the Ministry of Health will do, although we are an American company, we have a strong FCPA rules,
yeah.
But they have a lot of understandings, and we do a lot of initiatives with the government, with the Ministry of Health, to actually make sure that the patents are respected and so on. And so on.
I can share a statistics, which is published by U.S. Chamber of Commerce on most difficult versus easiest countries to enforce and protect IP. So the best countries which are ranked as number one are US, UK, Sweden, top three countries. China is ranked at 25th number, India at 36, United Arab Emirates at 32, and United Arab Emirates is in a watch list which is called Super 301, and Saudi Arabia and Kuwait are in priority watch list, you see. So despite the fact that we are talking about the easiness of protecting intellectual property rights, that the rights, somebody has done the research, you see, on these particular aspects. So this is where we stand. UAE was last year 24th in this list. It has slipped to 36, you see, in this, 32. So there are issues, you know, which needs to be addressed clearly over here.
Okay. Any more questions?
I am.
Yeah, I cannot see, sorry.
Yeah, I am totally agree with Mr. Farrukh, actually. I believe that litigation is not all for different one trademarks. In case of Bangladesh, I found that till the day peoples are not aware about their IP rights. Sometime we found that peoples are infringed once registered trademarks. Without knowing the law, there's IP infringing is the penal law under the Bangladesh penal code. And in this situation, I suggest my clients to send a cease and desist notice to the clients who are infringers. And I found, more times I found that they obey our cease and desist notice, that they don't, they promise that we will not infringe this registered trademark. And we found a successful result. And in that case, I support that litigation is actually not all for defend one's trademark.
Yes. Which jurisdiction is this?
In Bangladesh jurisdiction, I found it.
Yeah, I think you're very right. There, you can start with a cease and desist letter.
Yeah.
But there, you see, it depends on what the thing is. Sometimes when you send it to an infringer who is really infringing the matter, they would rush to the court and obtain an injunction against you from interfering in their business. So it is a strategy which you have to adopt. You see, you have to understand. This is a whole gambit. You see, you can't dissect and take it on an individual basis. Your lawyer has to devise a strategy in the best possible manner to protect your IP rights.
I'll add to that. So when we suppose our theatrical releases date is being fixed on, we open every Friday to Friday. Mm-hmm. So if it is fixed that a particular movie is supposed to release on Friday, so what we have started now doing is that we go to the offices of Facebook and YouTube, Earlier, if you would, if I'm sure most of us are on Facebook and other social media platforms, some people, they put the link of that torrent or the pirated, where you can see the pirated movie on Facebook. I'm sure most of you all have seen that. Or the movie used to come earlier on the YouTube channel. So what we started, you know, we have hand in gloves with Facebook and YouTube, and we go to Google offices and we tell them that the minute if we see our content is being pirated on your platforms, you will have to take it down. So we send out a cease and desist letter, and immediately they will plug it out. And a notification goes to that particular user as well that we will block your account if you don't put down this link.
I don't talk that a cease and desist notice are always successful. Sometimes we found they don't obey our cease and desist notice. Then in that case, we have go to administrative law enforcing agencies like police or like that. Then police sometimes are biased in respect of the infringers.
Yeah, yeah, of course, yeah. But see, in this case, I don't have to, nor do I have to go to the cops, nor do I have to go to the government. Because I have established relationship with Facebook and Google and YouTube, Instagram, Twitter. I just have to pick up a phone and tell them that plug it out. I do not go to any of the government authorities. Otherwise, it will take a long time. Till that time, there are millions of users who will click on that link and start watching my content. And I will lose out on my revenue. So I have cut the cord and I straight go to the platform and tell them to plug it out.
And this is kind of lobbying as well coming too.
Yeah. Sorry?
This is kind of lobbying as well.
If yes.
This is like informing for
informing,
your rights.
Informing.
But
yeah.
B's lobbying is a different lobbying, which is to change the law.
I'll tell you about law. How
go to the government.
You don't change the law.
You don't lobbying have to change the law.
Okay.
You know, I would second her thought that in terms of lobbying as well, what we in India, especially in Bombay, again when the movie is out on the third day, we used to have hawkers who used to sell the CDs, you know, on the roadside, especially out of any bus stop or railway stations. There used to be shops, legitimate shops where people are selling CDs of the movies which has been just released 2 days before. So the industry and the people, they started, you know, talking to the cops and the government and the court that this has to go because this is not allowed. So, but within, I think, 1.5 years, now we do not see them sitting on the road. Of course, the technology has enhanced, but at least this thing has stopped.
Yeah, so now we have time for one more
question. So I'm just going to add a comment here to the lobbying aspect. So when you talk about Pakistan, lobbying is very widespread, on a very widespread account, prevalent in Pakistan. And this is not, it's not to influence, but again, it is to motivate laws to be churned in a way that facilitate business. For example, with the Overseas Chamber of Commerce is very, very active in Pakistan, and they have actually, you know, promulgated laws for, and customs has, you know, made their own rules for exports. So it's not, I mean, yeah, it's not a clear black and white, but to a great extent, I think lobbying does help businesses to get their word out and then promulgate laws in that manner, because essentially IP is, you know, it's directly related to investment. So if you can't get your word out to the legislators, then, you know, this is not something which is illegal per se, but again, if you're doing it at the right forum, which, you know, has a legal means of motivating legislators to provide those legislations, then I think that lobbying is pretty much the way to go for a lot of businesses.
So I think the key word here is lobbying, the one that you proposed. And now this is all what we have time for, guys, and I just need to give you a heads up about the trick I have played at the beginning. So basically when I do this, you guys do what